Hello everybody, welcome back to our little lecture series on microwave engineering. Today's topic is the paradigm of microwave engineering. Why do we do microwave engineering? Why don't we just stick with the general electrical engineering? So the big question is, why do we do microwave engineering? Network theory is linear. When you scale the frequency, all the elements scale and everything scales. So what's the problem? In theory, there's no need for microwave engineering because everything is linear in the frequency range. However, in practice, there are some problems that arise. The first problem is that the lumped elements are not ideal at higher frequencies, as I will show you in a second. The second problem is that we need extremely small element values to realize any filter structure or matching structure. And the third problem is that our signal changes in time as fast as the speed of light. And since the signal propagates with the speed of light or a little bit less, that means that we run into problems as soon as we insert transmission lines into our circuit. Let's take a look at the lumped element values first. So that's the very first problem. When I build an extremely simple low-pass filter, for example, with a cutoff frequency of 200 megahertz, then I choose my element values according to filter theory. I get a 65 nanohenry inductor, I get a 22 picofarad capacitor, and as a result, I get a response which looks something like this. The blue line is my transmission. We get a very nice 0 dB transmission at low frequencies, and we get a big attenuation at high frequencies. On the opposite, the reflected signal is the purple line. We get almost no reflection at low frequencies when everything is transmitted. However, everything is reflected at high frequencies. So that's the theory. Let's see what happens when I actually build this kind of circuit.
So this is
I picked a 65 nano low pass filter inductor, and I picked a 22 picofarad capacitance, and I build up
filter now to this the Anritsu network analyzer. It's made of two black boxes, port 1 and port 2. We attach both sides to the network analyzer's ports. We tighten the bolts, not too tight. Usually a torque wrench is used, however this one is not available right now, so I just tighten it by hand. So now our device is ready for measurement. I have to tighten it a little bit more here. Okay, now we can start measuring our device. We are now in the Anritsu Shockline graphical user interface for the network analyzer. I display right now the response of my filter from 150 kilohertz to 2 gigahertz. And as you see, the yellow line is my transfer function and the green line is my reflection. You can see nicely that the low pass filtering is given. Here down in this range, we get a good transmission, and then the transmission goes down with frequency. On the other side, my reflection is low, minus 15 dB at low frequencies, and is high at high frequencies. Altogether, this is a nice low-pass filter, no question about it. However, you observe something interesting, and that is this part here. According to my theory, this line should go down linearly. However, in reality, it goes down and then goes up again, then it goes down and it goes up again. And here it goes up, up, up. And I expect at 4 or 5 gigahertz, my low pass filtering is not given anymore because we get another pass band. So why is that? In theory, this should go down. However, in the real application, we see this funny behavior. Let's go back to our theory now. Okay, once again, in theory, we should see a transmission that decays with frequency and a reflection that goes up. And in our measurement, we see that decay and transmission, however, we see this funny up and down here. Well, in order to figure out the reason behind that, let's go to a much more simple problem. Let's take a look at the impedance of a 10 picofarad capacitor. Well, the impedance of a capacitor follows our simple equation, 1 over j omega c. So the bigger the omega, the smaller the impedance becomes. And since it's a 1 over j, it's a pure reactance, and with 1 over j, that makes it minus j, so it's a negative reactance. Let's take a look at the plot of the frequency response of that 10 picofarad capacitor in a range of 150 kilohertz to 2 gigahertz. Well, in order to get the desired plot, I write a small Python program, a very simple program using Pylab. We define a frequency range as an array from 150 kilohertz to 2 gigahertz with step size 100 megahertz or 10 megahertz, sorry. Our capacitance value is 10 to the minus 12 farads. Our impedance becomes 1 over 1j 2 pi fc following the formula. Now we only have to plot that. We create a figure with an axis handle, plot the figure with a frequency range divided by 1E9, that makes the frequency in gigahertz. Then I plot as the y-axis the imaginary part of my Zin, and I plot it in red. I scale my axis to have a nice looking view. I put a grid on, and I set my labels of the x and the y-axis, and later on I save my figure as cap10picofarads.svg. So I run the program and I take a look at the plot, and that's the plot that's generated. As expected, the impedance decays and goes towards zero with a 1 over omega behavior. It's negative, and at 100 or 200 kilohertz, it's about minus 200, 300 ohms.
So we have now attached a 10 picofarad
gigahertz
capacitor
still
to a little SMA connector,
minus,
as you can see,
5
here.
Minus
and
10
I attach this capacitor now to our
now,
network.
That's a theory.
We only need one
like
port
in
right now.
Real life.
Because
let's make a measurement.
So now we can start measuring.
Okay, I started the Anritsu Shockline program now, which is a GUI for our network analyzer. In that GUI, you can see now three different plots. The one in the upper left is the imaginary part of my impedance. The lower one here is the real part of the impedance. And the right one is the Smith chart. You can see in the Smith chart clearly the behavior of my impedance. At frequency zero, we start here at open. And then when we increase the frequency, we keep moving along the outer edge of the Smith chart in the capacitive area, and the capacitance becomes, the impedance becomes smaller and smaller and approaches zero. This you can also see here in this plot, the imaginary part, the reactance of our impedance has this typical behavior of 1 over omega. It comes from minus infinity and approaches zero. However, you see the zero line is here. Eventually, it will cross over the zero line and becomes positive. Positive, that means we are an inductor. So that's strange. Down there, the real part should be zero, and this is also more or less a case. At higher frequency, you see we get some kind of a real part in my impedance. So that's strange. Why is my capacitor becoming an inductor? Well, it has definitely to do with the fact that our capacitor has two long leads, and each lead carries a magnetic field. So the magnetic field is inductive. So one problem at high frequencies is when you use components with long leads, you run into problems.
because you create parasitic inductances. So first rule is don't use elements with long leads. Use surface-mount devices which do not have any leads. So first thing we do is we switch to another capacitor which doesn't have leads. So that should give us better results. Let's switch to the other capacitor. Okay, we now take a look at our network analyzer output using the SMD 10 picofarad capacitor. Something changes here. We still have our line on the Smith chart, which goes around. However, when we look at our impedance, the reactive part looks like this. It's below zero and about 1.6 gigahertz, it crosses over to zero. So we pushed our frequency to way up and we still have a capacitor. And our impedance now, our real part of the impedance now is more or less exactly zero now. So that looks good, however, not perfect. We see that up in at 2 gigahertz plus, we still have an inductor where we should have a capacitor. Let's compare this behavior with the ideal behavior now. In order to do so, we have to save our measurement by going to Save Data here in the File menu. And we select one port because we have only one port device. And we save it as a 1 picofarad SMT device and say Save. So we replace it. Okay. So now we saved our measurement as a so-called touchstone file and can import this now into Python. Let's do that. Okay, we are in the JupyterLab environment now in order to program some Python. I prepared something already. I loaded our PyLab magic, so we have all our PyLab functions. And I also already included the code we did before in order to plot the theoretical response. Here you see it again. That's the theoretical imaginary part of the impedance of a 10 picofarad capacitor. Now let's go and load our touchstone file. The touchstone file is saved at this weird location, this one I put in already. I also already imported the microwave module as MW. This module we need in order to import our touchstone file. The microwave module is available on our Aulis page, which is an internal module for our Hochschule students. So now we can load our touchstone file by saying mw.loadTouchstone. And then the file name, which is fname. And as a result, we get two arrays. One is my array of the measured frequencies. And the other array is my S11 data, which is, I can just call S11. So this one loads a touchstone file and as output, we get a vector with the measured frequency values and a vector with the measured reflection coefficient values, so-called S11 values. In order to make it more obvious, I can rename my S11 data to gamma. Gamma holds now my reflection coefficient values for the frequencies. Next, we have to convert gamma to the impedance Z. And my Z in measured is now 50 ohms times the well-known formula 1 plus gamma over 1 minus gamma. So this is a formula for converting my reflection coefficient gamma to the input impedance Zn. Now we have these two values and we can plot them. And in order to plot them, I just copy over my lines I have done already for the other file. I only have to change this to F measured and to Z in measured. So, and now at the blue line, we get our measured input impedance of my capacitor, which is the measured impedance. I would like to compare this obviously with my theoretical results. That's why I also plot my original values here. I copy them down and plot them next. So now I get two plots. One is the theory and one is the measured value. In order to make it clear, I give it some labels. This one is the measured, so call it measured, and this one is the theory, so I call it theory, and I have to put a legend somewhere, so I say ax.legend. So, and I a typo in here, so so now we can take a look at our results. At low frequencies, both lines are identical. So the 10 picofarad capacitor is a perfect 10 picofarad. At higher frequencies, however, they deviate. We get one line, the theory, which approaches zero, and the blue one actually eventually crosses zero. And so you see the bigger the frequency becomes, the more my actual capacitor deviates from the ideal one. And that's going to cause problems at frequencies, well, let's say above 1 gigahertz, 2 gigahertz, no? So we run into problems. Okay, let's take another look. This becomes even more clear when we plot it in log scale. I prepared this already here. So in log scale, the only thing I do is I change it from plot to log, and then I get a new plot, and you see the red dots here are my measured values, and the blue line is my ideal behavior. You see at low frequencies, this is pretty much the same, and then here at about half a gigahertz to 1 gigahertz, it deviates, and you get this funny shape here. You get actually a resonance effect where it's exactly zero and then the impedance goes up again. So this has to be investigated further. Okay, let's take a closer look at our real capacitor. When you look at the real capacitor, that's this little thingy here at the end of my connector. What we measure is we measure the impedance of the whole structure. That means we measure the contacts here of my connector. We measure the little posts here that hold my capacitor. We measure the solder that holds the capacitor, and so on and so on. And that leads to a non-perfect behavior of my capacitor. The biggest effect by far is the effect of these little lines going to the capacitor. They carry a current, and the current produce a magnetic field, which results in a tiny but available magnetic field. And this again means when you create a magnetic field, you have an inductor. When you put everything together, you can create an equivalent circuit for my real capacitor, which is a 10 picofarad capacitor in series with a 14.7 nanohenry inductor and a 4 ohm resistor from all of that. And you cannot get rid of the other elements because they are part of the mechanical structure. You can minimize them by making the lead shorter, but you can never get 100% rid of these parasitic effects. That's why at very high frequencies, it's not useful to use lumped elements. Eventually, your parasitic elements will be larger than your actual value of your element. This is a plot of the model, the orange, and the real measured values. We see that we get a very nice fit already. So in conclusion, lumped elements do not behave as expected at higher frequencies. Do not use lumped elements beyond 1-2 gigahertz. They just won't work. The second problem closely related to this is that you need very small element values. Let's make a little calculation here as an example. Let's say we need a 10 ohm impedance inductor at 10 kilohertz, 10 megahertz, and 10 gigahertz. Let's calculate the required inductance. The inductance is just my 10 ohms over my frequency. So when I do a little Python program here for 10 kilohertz, 10 megahertz, 10 gigahertz, and loop through that, I get the values for my inductances. At 10 gigahertz, I need an inductance of 0.159 nanohenry. That's an extremely small value. And this value is eventually much smaller than the parasitic value you get. Let's take a look at a typical manufacturer of inductances. Here, Fast Run Group, from their data sheet, you can go and see what inductors they have available. And we look here, the smallest value that's available is this 2.7 nanohenry. So you cannot buy smaller inductance values than 2.7 nanohenries because it doesn't really make sense. Your parasitics are bigger than your actual inductance value. That means when you need an inductor at 10 gigahertz, you cannot use a coil as mentioned here. You have to come up with something else. The third problem is that your signal varies so quickly at 10 gigahertz or 1 gigahertz that it's comparable to the velocity of light. Again, let's make a little example. Let's assume we have a 3 meter long transmission line. Well, when we're in vacuum and the line is 3 meters long, how long does it take for the signal to propagate through the line? Well, it's the length of the line over the velocity, which is 10 to the minus 8 seconds, so it takes 10 nanoseconds to go from one side to another. So what happens to a signal with a period of 2 times this delay? So when I get a signal that has 20 nanoseconds period, then we get from here to here a 180 degree phase shift. And that might be catastrophic. 20 nanoseconds, when you convert it to frequency, 1 hour period, you get 50 megahertz. No? So when you feed in a signal with 50 megahertz, 5 volts here, you get at the output a signal at minus 5 volts. That's obviously not the same. That means whenever you include a transmission line somewhere at high frequencies, you're going to change the phase of the signal and you get a different signal, which is usually not what you want. So that also is a problem. At high frequencies, you cannot use pieces of transmission lines.
For the demonstration, I use a 5-inch-long semi-rigid cable from mini circuits. This cable is about 13 centimeters long, as you see.
You can also make a small demonstration of that using our setup with a network analyzer.
Cable to my network analyzer, port 1, and I leave the other port just open. So when I measure it, I get about 13 centimeters in total length. Hooking up this open-ended transmission line to my network analyzer, I see the following plot. In the Smith chart, extremely typical, the point moves around and moves around the Smith chart. And impedance, imaginary part and real part. The imaginary part comes from minus infinity because it's an open end, goes to zero,
switch
as a short, goes to positive to infinity, minus infinity,
load.
Zero, so positive infinity, minus infinity, and so on.
To the end of
That's
the
a
line.
Typical tangents beta L behavior of a transmission line. You may remember that from our Wellenausbreitung module. We start at 100 ohms, then our 100 ohm with frequency gets transformed into a 25 ohm
impedance, then it goes up again to 100 ohms, then again to 25 ohms, then again to 100 ohms, and so on. This is not ideal because our 100 ohm termination is a big blob, and that makes it not perfect. Also, my transmission line is fairly lossy. As you can see here, we start exactly at 100 ohms, then we go to 25 ohms, and then we come back, we are not at 100 ohms, we are a little bit higher, and then the line moves out, out, as I get more and more losses into my system. So this, as a result, tells us the third problem. Whenever you insert a transmission line into something, at high frequencies, you will vary the behavior of the circuit extremely. So just with classical network theory and classical electrical engineering, we cannot build circuits that perform at several gigahertz frequencies. We have to come up with something else.